The topic that I want to share with you today or tonight is, are you ready? You know, and it might be, I'm so into this, are you ready? I got it for the Shepherd of Sheep Sunday too, so, but it is, when are we going to be ready? You know, and when are we going to stand up and do something for the Lord? And a lot of you guys are very active. You know, I'm not saying you aren't. But how many of us have said that, you know, that's nice. You know, we hear this about abortions and all the babies dying. Human trafficking. We hear about these girls being taken and sold into sexual slaves. You know, what are we doing about it? Somebody brought up with Victor Marx. You remember him? He came a couple of times, the, you know, kung fu dude. He had, you know, he's over in Iraq, you know, and grabbing people out of positions like this. You know, and I'm going, whoa. I'm glad that God didn't call me there. You know, everybody says, I'm glad God didn't call me there. You know, there's some wild people out in Hawaii I want to go minister to, you know, kind of thing. But Iraq, I don't know. I don't know if I want to go there. But there are things that God places before us, you know, and that we would stand up and, because time's getting short. Everybody goes, well, we're in the last days. They've said that forever. You know, the disciples were saying, is this now the time? And the Lord says, you know, it's not for me to tell you. It's only that the Father knows. The Father knows, but how much time do we have left? And then to see, you know, we don't know, do we? How long we have, none of us know. You know, and I'm getting older. It says that man has been given 70. I'm looking back at that time, and some of us are, you know, there's more people. Maybe you won't admit you're old as me, but, you know, that 70 is 70. Now, I'm looking backwards at that. You know, how much longer is God going to give me? And I want to share the Lord with as many people as I can till I die. I'd love to be sharing with somebody and just fall over dead. No, I'm not going to say that. No, but you know that would be the last thing that I was doing was sharing Christ. You know, the other night I went into a hospital visit praying for this guy, and he didn't know the Lord, and I'm sharing with him. Come out from behind the curtain, it was two people in the room, and this elderly man, his wife was feeding him some soup, and I go, man, you have really a good nurse, don't you? And he says, the best. And then the wife goes, could you pray for us? And could you lead us in the sinner's prayer? They wanted to accept the Lord, and I'm talking to a guy over here. So there's always these opportunities, you know, and it's not just me, and I'm not the greatest soul winner in the world, but I give it one heck of a try because I want to tell people about Jesus. And I'm going to share with you a couple different stories, you know, biblical people, and then I'm going to share with you a real-life example that truly it does happen today. And there are people like Paul. You know, there are people like Nehemiah today, right here amongst us. We just got to stand up and start doing it. So let's pray and we'll get into the Word. Father, we thank you and we praise you, Lord God, for who you are, what you've done in our lives. Lord, I want to thank you right now for saving us, for pulling us out of that pit, delivering us from that, really, from death. We were dead in our sins and trespasses, and you made us alive, Lord God. We need to realize that and to see where we were and where you brought us, Lord God. And Father, that we would have that in our hearts to be so thankful for what you've done for us. Lord, I pray that what I share tonight, men might receive. And Father, that we might be encouraged to take that next step. And when somebody says, are you ready? We can say, here I am, Lord, send me. And I ask that in Jesus' name, amen, amen. So the first man we're going to look at, as I shared, is Nehemiah. And chapter 1 in Nehemiah, and I'm not going to go into any theology thing, but I just want to point out to you this man, Nehemiah. And it says, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hekaliah, it came to pass in the month of Shivas, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, that Hanani, I'm glad that I'm born now, that names are easier, you know, that I'm going, whoa. If you say them really fast and nobody ever questions you on if you said them right or not. You know, I've found that out over the years. But Hannah and I, one of my brethren came with men from Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the Lord God of heaven. You know, so now we see a man that asks a question, he gets an answer. He gets an answer, and it says that the people, his people, that escaped from Babylon are there in Judah, and they're under great distress. Now you hear something, you hear a need. How am I going to, you know, do this? How am I going to fulfill this, and how can I minister to these people over there? It was a burden on his heart. So he didn't just say, well, that man, I'm going to pray for them. He prayed and said, Lord, how can I minister to these people? And he was the cupbearer, you know, of the king. One of the things that you didn't want to go in and bum out the king. So he had a problem before him. When we have a problem or something that stands in our way, do we just stop and don't go any further? Because we know the need, it touched his heart, what are we going to do about it? So he goes to the king, and the king said to me, and this is chapter 2, why is your face so sad since you are not sick? This is nothing but sorrow of heart. So I became dreadfully afraid because the king could have had him killed. You know, you ruined my breakfast. You know, and he could have had him killed for that. So it's a, and it goes on, and it says, and the king said, may the king live forever. This is what Nehemiah said. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tomb, lies waste? You know, here he was in a very precarious position. You know, the king could have had his life taken, and he's sharing with him the burden on his heart. It was so heavy. He wasn't, and a lot of us have got in that place to where, you know you have to share something, but you're afraid for one reason or another. A lot of us are for position of work or anything that I would stand up or mention God, what could happen to me. He could have been killed. His life could have been taken. Then the king said to me, what do you request? Oftentimes we're so afraid, but then when we step out and we really take that opportunity, doors open. Who would have ever thought the king would have said that? But it could have kept him from not taking that next step. And that's what I wanted to share with you, because the king opened doors. We see the city rebuilt, the walls, you know, fortified, the gates being put up, the people being restored to that position because of a man was ready. He seized the opportunity, and he fulfilled it. The next one is back in Acts. And chapter 16, verses 1 through 10. And this is, Paul and his ministry. And you look at and wrote, a good part of the New Testament. But he came from such a horrible background, kind of thing of killing the Christians to becoming like one of our heroes in Christianity of what this guy did. And he faced, he was beaten. He was stoned, left for dead. He gets up. He wants to share with them again. And we go, what was empowering that guy? And he says, the only thing, good thing in me is Christ Jesus. So he was empowered by the Lord, the Holy Spirit. We have that same power within us. It's what are we doing with it? We go around and we tell people, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm baptized with the Holy Spirit. But what are we doing? We need to show those fruits. We need to have that example of a Christian not only saying something, but doing something, living. Then he came to Derbe. This is in chapter 16. And Lystra. And behold, a certain disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a certain Jewish woman who believed, but his father was Greek. He was well spoken of by the brethren who were in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted to have him go on with him, and he took him and circumcised him. Now, Timothy had to be pretty much, hey, I want to serve the Lord too, because here he's, you know, 16, 18, 20 years old, and now Paul says, hey, you want to go in the ministry? Come over here. I'm going to circumcise you. You know, I had a guy in high school that wasn't circumcised, and he was circumcised when he was in high school. Man, I mean, that guy suffered. It was not easy to go through that. Now, doctors have come a long way since this time, you know, kind of thing. So I go, he come at me with a knife. I'm going, maybe I shouldn't go on this missionary journey with you. You know, is there another place I could go? You know, something a little bit easier? Because there were Jews, you know, and that needed to be ministered to. And this was a sign to the Jews that it would open doors for him to minister. As they went through the cities, they delivered to them the decrees to keep, which were determined by the apostles and the elders in Jerusalem. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and increased in number daily. Now, when they had gone through Perga to the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word to Asia. You don't have to know the reason why, but you have to see God speaking to these people. All of us have probably said one time or another, man, I wish God would just speak to me, lead me, give me direction. Here it is. It did it here. They weren't allowed to go to this place. How did that happen? You know, because they sought the Lord with their whole heart. They were going, you know, and they didn't have all the media and different things that we had. They had to spend time with the Lord. The scriptures were not as plentiful as what we have today, but it was that mindset that I want to serve God. So we see they were, by the Holy Spirit, they weren't allowed to go to this place. I feel wholeheartedly that God can do that with us. You know, if you want to serve him, I think he will direct you and guide you. It's the fact of, it's not on the Holy Spirit's fault that he doesn't move like he used to. It's our fault that we don't allow him to move in our lives like the early church did. And they had persecution. What's keeping us? You know, kind of thing, we're not persecuted. Somebody might say, oh, you're a Christian? And right away we go, oh, man, my life's over with. You know, that's about the persecution we have. After they had come to Mercia, they tried to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. I mean, they're being guided. You talk about, you know, I always tell people my Bible is my GPS system. You know, God's perfect solution for everything that I might have. It's right here. They tried to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. So passing by Mysia, they came to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man from Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. Now, after he had seen this vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel there. You know, and he dreamt a dream. You know, and the Bible says that young men dream, old men have visions. You know, I'm not getting visions, but are you guys getting dreams? You know, kind of thing. It's like, if I had a woman one time that used to have these horrendous dreams, and she was afraid to go to sleep. She felt that she'd die in her sleep. And I thought she was watching these horror movies, you know, of people whacking each other, but she said she didn't do that. But I got her on a program of having... back then it was a cassette. So those are those little things, if you guys don't know, that you put in a machine and it talks to you. But that's in the past. But she did that. The last thing she heard at night, what is the last thing that we hear at night? You know, kind of, and she started that. And the first night, she went to sleep and she slept the whole night. And she didn't have those dreams because the last thing she heard was God's word. It was nothing else, because the enemy knows, man, if we have a door open a little bit, he's going to come in and start lying to you, you know, and speaking to you and having you, you know. When I grew up, I had, we lived in an old house, and when I was home at night, the floors would start creaking in the kitchen and go through the dining room, the living room, my folks' bedroom, down the hall, and right into my bedroom. And there had been a man that was killed in our house. You know, and this was before I knew the Lord. So I slept with a baseball bat in my bed because I was so afraid. There wasn't nightlights back then. You had to start a fire, you know, kind of thing or in the house. But, you know, I was scared. I tell people, I'm going, man, I was so happy that my mom never came in and tried to kiss me goodnight because I'd have felt bad smacking her with my bat, you know. But we look at both these situations. Now, these are biblical, Old Testament, New Testament stories that we read. And we go, you know, that was then. Things have changed. This is different. You know, and a lot of times I feel that same way. But I had the privilege of doing a memorial service the other day for I always miss the name. Ishdora Izzy, we'll call him. Is his son here? His son was going to come tonight. But he was born in Mexico. At the age of 23, the Lord rescued him from sin through a young banker who shared the gospel with him, and he was born again. So now we see a banker coming to this guy. He was an alcoholic. Shared with him, he came to the Lord at 23 years old and made a decision to give his life entirely to the Lord. He went to Bible school. God sent him to serve him in Mazatlan, Sinaloa, where an amazing journey began, and he started planting churches. You know, he planted churches, and it says in Topeka, he called to build a mission. He went there. Was on a radio station called Las Pera, Las Perdosas, the Light of the Lost. You know, and he went from there to Guadalajara, a tough city. At that time, they were persecuting Christians, and a lot of times we go away from there. You know, Pastor Hector and some of the guys went to this, and I think some of you went to the One Ways and went to a park there and did an outreach. When I was young, you didn't. Guys, my shade of brown didn't go into the One Ways. You know, kind of, it was not a good place for me to go. We would not go there. It was scary. But here now, people penetrated and went, those people need Jesus too. I don't care where it is. Now he goes to this Guadalajara and he starts a church. And he, you know, at the cost of his life. His goal, this great man of God, had a goal in his life, which was for every man and woman to accept Jesus Christ as his Savior. And it goes on. There's different churches that he planted. He came to California. He planted a couple churches here. And then he was called back to Mexico. It happens today, man. It does. It happened to this man, you know, kind of thing. And it can happen to each and every one of us. We just need to be ready for that call, what God has for us. You know, and I'm going to give you some scriptures now as far as, and this was, a lot of this is from Saturday. But I looked at this and I'm going, if God can do that in the Old Testament, if God can do that in the New Testament, if God can do it here, and God did it in my dad's life. God did, my dad was my hero. You know, I didn't know the Lord when my dad first come down with cancer, and you know, he's in there, and they used to have cancer wards with 8-10 people in a bedroom. And he would be in there at the end at 8 o'clock, visiting hours are over. He'd say, we're going to have a prayer meeting. And all these people would gather around, and he'd minister to those people. He was like Paul. His was a hospital bed. Paul was in a boat, and he'd go here, go there. But my dad would share, and I'd be outside. I could not go in the room with my dad. And I'd stand outside and just cry, because my dad was dying, but the Lord was in there, and I hated God. I hated God because did some stuff to me that I thought, man, that's not right. And I didn't want anything to do with him. So anytime with my dad, I couldn't go in the room. It was so powerful that it just kept me. Because I was just fearful of the Lord, of what he'd do next to me. And this man was 23, I was 29, and it was instrumental. My dad was instrumental in my coming to the Lord. He went through all of this, never questioned, never said, why me? I was wishing this cancer to go away and whack some other. I had a lot of people that I thought, man, I'd rather have him have cancer than my dad. You know, but that didn't work either. But it took me a long time, even after that, of seeing my dad just going down to nothing. You know, and a man came into my life, just like these people. His whole thing was, I'm going to share Christ with as many people as what I can. Why are we here as Christians if we're not sharing the Lord? What purpose is it of you guys or me if we're not sharing the Lord? I don't know why we're here then. If we're not that example that people could follow after, then why are we here? What hope does the world have if we walk around like hopeless people, you know? We have the Lord. God has brought us out of a pit, man. Some of us were, you know, good sinners, and then there were some of us that were bad sinners, you know, kind of thing, but we were all sinners. You know, and in John 17:18, and these are things that I want you guys, as you have your table talk, to discuss, but Jesus said, as you sent me, the Father sent him into the world. I have also sent them. Who are them? Is that just the disciples that Jesus ministered to at that time, just a small group of men? Or are we them? You know, I think we're them, isn't it? We're sent out into the world. We need to take heed to Jesus, what Jesus says. You know, and in Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, and it says, go therefore. You know, he tells us to go. I told the guys that are leaving for Louisiana, I told Isaac today, I said, you know, God says go. He never tells us to come back. But Scott came, you came back, didn't you, Scott? Yeah, he's back. Jesus speaking to him, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You know, we see this. God, that's a command given to, I think, to us. You know, it doesn't stop and then, oh, that was for them. But we live in a whole different realm. You know, they had to go out into the world. The world has come to us. The world has really come to us in America, isn't it? I used to go to Artesia, and that was all Dutch when I grew up. Now it's India, so India has come to us. Then you can go to little Tokyo, and you can go to Saigon, and you can go all these places. You don't have to go across. If you're wanting to reach all the nations, they're right around us. But we have to start someplace, and that's why I encourage you guys to bring people to the men's breakfast. And that's not the biggest deal in the world. But I want you to interact with people that don't go to church, that don't know the Lord. That's what I want you guys to do. That's the encouragement that I come tonight, that you would do that. You know, the men's breakfast is another thing. You know, kind of, but it's just interacting with those people that don't know Christ. And I know that a lot of you work with them. You know, you drive by them. You go get gas. You go to these A&M markets and all these places. The world is right there. The world is right there, and I know there's a lot of lost people around this place. I can't, you know, like this man, you know, wanted everybody to know the Lord. I think we have to have that attitude, but I'm not able to share with everybody in the whole world. But I know one thing, if we'd all share with somebody, it would multiply, and the Lord's work would grow if we will go. You know, so that's what Jesus commanded. He gave to his disciples. You know, and in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and it says, But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all of Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And I know, I think everybody in here has prayed. You know, when you get that call, has anybody not received, would you like to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? And we pray to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You know, and you go, well, nothing happened. Well, take that step, you know, kind of thing, and see the power of God. You know, your car sitting in the garage doesn't need a lot of power. But you want that power when you take it out of the garage to step on the gas and you take off. That's what the Holy Spirit is. We're waiting, well, hey, I haven't had any fire on my head, you know, kind of thing, or anything such as that. But God is faithful to his word. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You know, he's the way that we should go. He's truth. His word, this, there's not a lie in this book. We need to come to that place of saying, I prayed for it. My heart was right for it, and I need to step out and to, you know, using the gifts just in a group like this, it encourages you to see that, but to go out and to take that step, to be ready to give an answer to someone that doesn't know the answer. And if you don't know the answer, we can find it, isn't it? We can hunt it down and we can look for it. So we see those scriptures. And you know, the rest of the scriptures, I had little paper things that I had all these scriptures, but my little girls got into my Bible. And so if you would help me out, would somebody look up John 18:36, and I'll try and find the first one, and we'll go from there. Okay, Galatians 1. Verse 4. So write these things down. Galatians 1, verse 4. And it says, starting in verse 3, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father. Delivering us from this. And people go, oh, I can't wait to be delivered from this. But he delivered you from this when you accepted him as your personal Savior. You know, when we look at communion we had last night, you know, that Jesus' blood was shed for us. You know, and we see that his blood was shed for the remission of our sin. And you look at all of the different sacrifices that the Jewish people made, sin sacrifices, a death had to take place. You know, something, an animal had to die. We see with Jesus had to die. His blood was shed for the remission or the forgiveness of our sins. And that's what we have to see in our lives. You and me have to die to the flesh. There needs to be a death before there can be that life. You know, and if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. There was a death. You had to die to that flesh, die to the world, and be delivered. So somebody have the John 18:36? You want to read it? Loud, because I'm deaf. Did everybody hear that? Yes. Write that one down, because, you know, God's kingdom is not, if Jesus said, if my kingdom was here, you know, Peter wouldn't have just cut off that dude's ear. He'd have whacked his head, you know, and there would have been a big fight, you know, and we'd have still overcome. But his kingdom is not here. And if we can realize that, I'm in the world, but I'm not of the world, you know, that we're elevated from that place, that the world doesn't control us. In 1 John 5, verses 4 and 5, it says, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that? Then we can overcome the world. The world doesn't have is powering us down. We need to overcome the world, but we're not, you know, of this world. And we have to see that. With Galatians 2, verse 20 also is a great verse. And it says, I have been crucified with Christ. So you see, a death has taken place. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You know, and to see that, the life that I live, it's really Christ living in me. I mean, it goes beyond. You go, oh my goodness, you know. Our spiritual growth, joy, and fruitfulness require that we maintain a proper perspective of the world, of what the world is. It's not designed to bring you closer to God. You know, any of us that have had a dramatic, I think every salvation dramatic, but being, you know, captive in a lifestyle and being delivered from it, I felt that I was doomed. You know, the lifestyle that I had, I thought I was doomed. I would live that, I couldn't get out of it. Every time I tried to get out of it, I go deeper into it. And it was just, I came to the place that I tried to kill myself. And I wasn't real good at that because I tried four different times. And, you know, it's like I always tell people I'm like a retired kamikaze pilot. You know he didn't do the job too good. But I wanted to die. But now I want to live. I'm going to live forever, but I want to live for God while I'm here. You know, and I don't know. But that proper perspective. In Hebrews 11:13, it says that we're strangers or exiles in this earth. We're strangers. This is not our home. Heaven's our home. You know, we're just, and Philippians 3:20, our citizenship is in heaven. That's where our citizenship is. We need to look past what we're going through to heaven. And all of us have went through some heavy things in our life. A couple of years ago, my daughter overdosed on heroin, and most of you guys know that, and she died. That was heavy. That was something that was so hard for me to deal with. And without God, and without you guys, and I don't know if everybody prayed for me, but I know there were a lot of people praying, and I could feel the burden of that tragedy being lifted off of me. You know, kind of thing, and that's all, man, I can't thank you guys enough, but without God, man, it showed me I can't do it. What is it going to take for us to all come to that place? Without God, I can't do it, and allow him to come to that place of empowering you and you going beyond what, you know, what's holding you back right now. Most of what's holding us back is just us. You know, you look in the mirror and you go, there's my problem. You know, kind of thing. God's not my problem. He's empowered me. I need to just grab hold of that and plug into that power. Philippians 3:20, our citizenship is in heaven. 1 Peter 2:11 says we're sojourners and pilgrims, strangers. And sojourners, the definition of that would be to live somewhere temporarily or to visit. That's what we are, isn't it? We're here temporarily. We're just here on a visit. One day we're going to go home, and when that day comes, you know, we're going to have a mansion prepared for us. Jesus said it. I believe it. And I want to, you know, as he's working for my mansion up there, I want to work for him. Not to prove to him that I'm good, but to prove to him how good he is. And he gave me life, and I want to worship him as long as I can. But until we realize this, that we're not, you know, this isn't our home, you know, and to get that mentality, until we realize that basic truth and live it, we will be ineffective in reaching the world with the truth of the gospel, because you just won't do it. I got to get along here, man. I don't want to make any waves. Paul made some waves. You know, and people wave back at him with stones and with whips and the different things. You know, yes, he had some persecution. Did it stop him? Did he run home? Did he sit in the corner and suck his thumb? No, he kept on. I mean, the one time he was, they left him for dead. You know, his friends come, they cleaned him up a little. He wants to go right in the same town again and preach the gospel. He goes to, you know, and sees all of these idols that people were looking at. You can see that same thing today, the idols, the people that are preaching these flowery things and never talk about sin or what it can do and how it can hurt you. I want to make you feel good. I don't want to have you think about sin or any of that stuff. You know, let's just jump up and down. You know, in one church they had that you would laugh in the spirit. You know, and I'm going, where do people get this? And then they were barking. They barked in the spirit. Now I can bark. I know how to bark, man. I drive dogs crazy in my neighborhood, you know, kind of thing. They want to. I'm just glad they can't get out of their cage because I'd be hurt, you know. But Romans 12, verse 2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." I know that my mind was jacked up, man, in the world. It took me over a year to deal with straight people. I could not handle straight people. I didn't know how to react or to act with them. But by reading the word and just having a desire, because when I met Jesus, I had to apologize to him and say, you know what, you're not who I thought you were. And I wanted to know him better, just like in these groups. You know, some of you here maybe for the first time, but that you can get to know guys here that are on the same page as you, that desire the best for you. You know, kind of thing, we're not miracle workers, but we're all people seeking God. We can be an encouragement. The last friend that I had in the world, well, this is before I got saved. I got some friends that aren't saved. The last guy that I hung out with gave me a .45 caliber pistol, and he told me, "This will take care of all your problems." That was my friend. And it just really opened my eyes to see what the world wanted to do. The world wanted to take me out, to kill me. "This will take care of all of your problems." And I heard God speak to me right at that time. And he said, "You're going to live." And that scared me because I thought I'd be in a mental institute. And I thought, that's worse. That's worse than where I am now. But he was saying, "You're going to live eternally separated from me." Now, there's a lot of people still in that same place that I was. And they need somebody like you. You know, they need somebody like you to come and share with them, because there's some people that are hopelessly lost in sin. We need a different mindset. Set our minds on things above and not on things below. What's below here and what we see right on this level dictates to our life. It controls us. And we need to be elevated. We need to be lifted up. Psalm 27 says that the Lord will lift me up, place me upon a rock, and my head will be above my enemies. And when you get that perspective, you can see a whole lot more. You know, it is only when we rise above the world that we can appreciate the appalling spiritual poverty in which most people live and learn to fix our minds on heavenly things. You can see, you know, a lot of us, you know, people don't like to talk about bad things, about dying. A lot of people don't like to talk about dying or their life ending. You know, but we can see people that are lost all around us. All around us. And we need to share with them, because the things most important to us are in heaven, and we can't be entangled with these things here on earth. In 2 Peter, and this is going to be, there's two more scriptures that I have. 2 Peter 2, verses 20 to 22. And it says, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse than the beginning." And I found that. I backslid. 2 years after I came to the Lord, I backslid and went out into the world. And I got entangled because I started listening to the promises of man rather than God's. God promised me a mansion in heaven. The guy I was working for promised me a house in Palos Verdes. The whole back was glass. You could see the ocean. And he said, Glen, one day you're going to have this. Satan will come as that angel of light and share with you that same thing. You know, he promised me cars, you know, kind of thing. And he gave me a car, and I had a business expense. And it started pulling me away. You know, and then I'm up one day, and he's, you know, I started not going to church and helping him on weekends fix his house and stuff. He's planting a lawn. You know, and he lights up a joint. A lot of you guys aren't familiar with that terminology, I guess, isn't it? But anyway, my first thought, because now I had drifted, my focus was not on the Lord. And when I accepted Christ, all these things were taken away from me. I didn't go to NA, BA, UPS, or any of them, you know, kind of thing. It was just Jesus, and he's healed me. Now I'm going back. Now I'm thinking about these things. And he lights up this joint, and I'm thinking, I wonder if it still has the same kick it used to. I wish God would have just kicked me upside the head when I said that, because I took a hit. For a year, I was held captive by drugs, you know, alcohol, and even women. You know, and I've confessed this to my wife, so you don't have to go, don't put it on Facebook, hopefully. But I have enough trouble just living life here without having it on Facebook. But I was there. How I came back to the Lord was through my wife, because she stood for Jesus all through this. And I was a horrible husband in this time. I wouldn't go to church. I would ridicule her. I'd plant pot in our terrarium, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, then she'd pick it up when it started budding and stuff. And I got all mad at her. But in this, she stood for the Lord. So I took her to a New Year's Eve party. And I commenced on just getting screwed up. I come downstairs and I look at my wife. And she's sitting there in a row of women, and they're passing joints back and forth, and there's my wife. And the Lord told me, in the midst of my stupidness, look at her. She doesn't belong here, and neither do you. You know what? I believe the Holy Spirit guides us and directs us even when we're acting stupid. And I walked out of that room, and I never again returned to that lifestyle. And my boss, he was a violent young guy, and he wanted to beat me up, you know, kind of thing, because nobody changes like that. Nobody. His dad started drinking. I was blamed for getting his dad back into alcohol because I stood up for Jesus. See how the world can distract us, though, and you get so tied up with these things? We got to look up. You know, and in 2 Timothy, this will be the last scripture, and I'll let you guys go. I enjoyed this so much, being with you guys, and I pray that this would be an encouragement that we just get busy for Jesus, because there's some of you here that wouldn't be here unless somebody told them about Jesus, isn't it? So somebody told me about Jesus. You know, 2 Timothy 2, verse 4. And it says, let's start. We'll go from the beginning. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men. Isn't that an encouragement to us? Let's commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others. See the progression of this? If I teach you, then you can teach others, and they can teach others, And this is how the family of God grows. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Verse 4, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And when I accepted Jesus Christ, I didn't sign up to be in a war, but I find out pretty quick that the enemy didn't like it that I came to Jesus Christ. And there was opposition, you know, but the Lord was there with me, and it was so evident in my life that I just pressed forward. And today I'm still pressing forward, you know, and with all that I have, I'm not, you know, as strong physically. I have some things going haywire with me, but you know what? I can still talk, I can still walk, and I can tell people about Jesus, and that's all there is. You know, I'm not a professional golfer. I'm not a semi-pro. There's a guy in my Tuesday morning Bible study that a little older than me, but he went to same school as me. I went to Valley Christian, and I was fairly good in sports. But to hear this guy talk, I was like the god of all baseball players. You know, he's always telling people this, and I go, Roland, I wasn't that good, man. I wasn't that good. You know, and but I'm very humble. I'm just kidding you, but you know, it's a lot of us are like legends in our own mind, isn't it, of what we used to do. And you know, I tell the people, I go, you know, in 2 Corinthians, I think it's the 10th chapter where it says, you know, that, or maybe it's 5, it's that we're a tent, and this tent is falling apart, but one day I'm going to that blessed home that's not built with hands, with human hands. And I have a gazebo in my backyard, and it's one of these canvas ones that just, the wind just tears that sucker apart, you know, kind of thing, and it has the windows are blowing out and everything, and I look at that and I go, that's me, but one day I'm going to be delivered from this. But it's still serviceable. We can sit under it, but it's got holes in it, and it just inspires me to go on, even if I have holes, you know, I got this hurts, that hurts, you know, kind of thing. I enjoy being a Christian, and I enjoy sharing the Lord with as many people as I can. You know, it's fun. I mean, just to see how you can get a conversation. I like to play golf, and people pay money to have me share Christ with them, because I'm out there with 3 guys that I don't know. And at any given point, the Lord opens doors, and I share the Lord with these people. You know, it's opportunities all over. And I don't see this as being my job, but I see it as a privilege that each and every one of us has. And it's a calling. It's a calling on every man in this place to be a disciple, to teach others what God has taught you. And if he hasn't taught you anything, then you got to get in the book. And you got to, because everything is here, man. I mean, everything. So I don't know what you guys discuss, but I pray that this would stimulate you to talk about these things, you know, to pray. Well, I don't know if I can. You know why people think they can't share the Lord? You know why? Because they never share the Lord. You don't know till you, and then you go, man, maybe that's the Holy Spirit that's working in me. You know, maybe I am baptized in the Holy Spirit, and you just start going for it, man, and God just puts the old steam to it, you know. So I'm going to pray, otherwise I'll go on forever, and I'm going to live forever, but you guys don't want me to talk that long, okay? So God bless you. Thank you, and thank Phil when you see him for... Because one of the blessings, and I count Phil as my Timothy. I didn't circumcise him. Don't you know, kind of thing. Don't you know? But he was raised up in the ministry under me. And I am so proud of this young man. I am proud of this young man, of what God has done. You know, and you guys are totally blessed, you know, kind of thing. And I've been around for so many years that there's a lot of guys that I've had just a little bit of influence in their lives, but they're serving God. You know, Ed Taylor was under me in ministry, you know, head of a large church in Colorado. You know, we have these, you know, Nachtaborns. You know, I went to school with his dad, you know, and had that time he was in ministry with me. It's like, what a blessing to teach others, and then they take over and just, it blows me away. It blows me away. It's so, God is alive, and he's well, and he's working, and Lord, just bless these guys. Minister to them. I pray that your word went out tonight and spoke to hearts. Change us, Lord. Get us excited about seeing others come to you and to know you. And Father, that it would stimulate us to know you more. Lord, I pray that in Jesus' name, that we would learn more about you, of who you are and what you desire to do in our life. Lord, let us not stop here. This is a beginning, and let each and every one of us press forward to that higher calling that is in Christ Jesus. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys.